Welcome back. In today's episode, I'm going to be talking to, I am talking to Evan Goldstein, Master Sommelier. And Evan calls himself, in his own bio, trilingual times three. So he speaks three languages, wine, food, and wine and food pairings. And he can do it in French, English, and Portuguese. He's an author, an educator, one of the, what do we say, Evan, a few hundred Master Sommeliers now?
That's a safe way. Yeah, absolutely.
A founding board member of BUSO, so the best USA Sommelier Association, co-owns two wine companies, so Full Circle Wine Solutions and Master of the World. Did I hear you're even associated with the San Francisco Giants?
I'm the official Master Sommelier of the San Francisco Giants, making me the first Master Sommelier officially designated to a major league sports team.
I think that is super cool. And for my own purposes, just because me and Evan now, I think we've had a few interactions now over the last couple of years, really great guy. So, which is really important to me for what I consider great sommeliers have to be really good people. So you began your hospitality career, not in the front of the house, as I understand, but in the kitchen, working at some pretty good restaurants in the San Francisco area before moving to the floor and working as a sommelier with your mother?
Correct.
At a restaurant called Square One in San Francisco, right? And then take that and then start writing a cookbooks and food and wine pairing books. So wine and food pairing, and then later Perfect Pairings, the practical advice for partnering wine with food. So let's just say, I mean, I have the gray hair. I don't know how you have so little gray hair, considering all you've done. But let's just say a real honor to be able to talk to you about wine and food pairing and really from a true master sommelier. So very exciting. So thank you.
I appreciate the opportunity to be with you and all of your colleagues out there. And thank you for your kind words. I am naturally blessed with good genes. Actually, neither my father nor my mother grayed until late in life. And I am the happy beneficiary of it. So I get stressed too, but my hair.
Well, I guess I'm the opposite. You know, my aunt and mom were probably gray in their late 30s and I followed suit. So I got to get my first gray hairs at about 35. So anyway, but let's talk about wine and let's talk about being a somm too. Mm-hmm. So, and because you're really, I mean, I assume it's your passion, your expertise. A lot of us know you about wine and food pairing. It's something I love too. Why do you think it's such an important skill as a somm to be able to relate or to think about wine, how the relationship between wine and food?
Absolutely. No, it's a great question and one that is not necessarily as obvious as the cover question itself asks. I think the basic reality is that for most people, when we're enjoying wines in restaurants or at table, it's part of this greater orchestration called a meal. And I do think that, you know, I've always believed wine makes food taste better. Food makes wine taste better. There are certainly arguments and times for enjoying food in a vacuum. And there's certainly arguments and times for enjoying wine in a vacuum. But more often than not, we enjoy them together. I mean, it's not by accident. There's a magazine out there called Food and Wine and not a magazine called Food and Scotch. Yeah. They share a very interesting relationship. As such, being the intermediary, if you will, between the guests who are dining with you, who are actually enjoying and imbibing and taking in the wine and the food, and the kitchen on the other side, your job as sommelier, as beverage director, wine director, is to essentially ensure that things work well together. Food people, chefs, by and large, because most of them don't have formalized wine training, or if they do, had it early in life, perhaps at culinary school, where they had it in week two of a three-year program, and by the time they graduated, they forgot everything that they learned, or they simply lack the curiosity about wine that they have with food, are not necessarily, and I know some great chefs who know a ton about wine, but they're more the exception than the rule. And the other reality is that many sommeliers tend to be extremely wine heavy and lack, again, curiosity in food, although they're certainly happy to enjoy it and eat it. The best sommeliers are those who can literally, as I sort of say in my, you know, somewhat self-effacing joke of being bilingual or trilingual, are able to be equally conversant in both sides, so that maybe they're not chefs themselves, but they understand the way food is, the way food works, the way food is prepared, and what that means with respect to wine. And they also understand wines well enough to know that all wines are not created equally. And there are certain clues and characteristics and attributes that wines have that make them magnetically attract themselves to certain genres of food. And your job, of course, is to be the orchestrator of all of this and do it well. And when it's done well, there is nothing more outstanding from an overall holistic dining experience than to have great wines with your cuisine and everything rocks on all cylinders. And then by the same token, nothing as bad as having a train wreck in your mouth because somebody didn't know what was going on.
Yeah, exactly. And I think so, like, and then when you come to doing it, and let's say you're probably a few years out of it, doing it day by day at a table, but it's still the passion and still in your head, you know, and I'm sure, I think we're probably North American sommeliers for a while, we're guilty of like, almost overthinking or being, you know, that it's one thing goes with one dish, one wine. Mm-hmm. And when you make food and wine pairings, do you believe in this kind of absolute relationship that a food item is supposed to go with a certain wine or wine style, or you kind of, do you kind of take a more broad approach that there's a lot of right answers to the answer to the what works?
You know, it's an excellent, I'm glad you brought that up. I think that I believe in guidelines. I don't believe in rules. I believe that your mouth is different than my mouth is different than the mouth of everybody out there watching this right now. And because we don't measure certain core things, sweetness, sourness, saltiness, heat in capsicums, Scoville units, all of that, the same way, it's really impossible to be able to say, do this with that. I think there are certain things that we can, I don't know, scare people, warn people. So for example, if you have a very dry wine with a very sweet food, regardless of our palates, we're all going to have essentially a similar adverse reaction. If you have something, a piece of fish that is uber fishy, chock full of fish oil, and a super tannic red wine, we're all going to have the same reaction. But bar those extremes, most everything is really a guideline. And I like to try and share characteristics and qualities and try and tell you, this is what kind of happens. See if it happens to you, with the understanding that we might not pick up things the same way, and not be so prescriptive. While I don't believe on the other extreme, honestly, Mark, and I don't believe in preaching anarchy, you know, if you want to have something with a hamburger, yes, and knock yourself out, that doesn't work for me. But also being too hard on, you must do this with that, you must have this with that, I think is disrespectful. And frankly, I think we underestimate the average person's common sense. And I think most people generally do have a pretty good one. And more often than not, they're just looking for, helping them steer into the lane a little bit better. And honestly, just for some validation and permission.
Right. So, okay. So you have some guidelines, but you seem within those guidelines, you allow yourself to go a few different directions. Would you consider yourself, like, I think some, you know, and again, I'll say this again, like, I think sometimes historically in North America, we're very analytical, you know, we're dissecting a dish and then dissecting a wine and trying to come up. And then, and maybe, you know, historically, maybe we could say that Europeans, because more in their culture and their heritage, just kind of go with the flow and have it in their soul. Do you think food and wine pairing is rooted in science? Or do you think there is a rooted in culture, personality? Like, is there a right way to do it, or should we be embracing both sides of the question, I guess, or, you know?
Honestly, Mark, both. I mean, I think there are times when one, I think you're right, cultures that have wine tradition, of which, you know, Europe, particularly in Western Europe, it's, you know, wine is on the table, the way olive oil, bread, salt, pepper, et cetera, there, and they're just part of life. Often, though, you find that if you dig a little bit deeper, you know, you ask your average, you know, person, you know, so what's in that Sancerre? And they're French, you just assume they know, and I did not know, you know, I know I enjoy the wine and all of that. So I do think it's quite easy to take it over the top and over dissect it and overthink it and do that, you know, and very much the the tradition of, you know, what grows together goes together regionally is a very explicit example of that. When people just, you know, they enjoy what they have, whether it's a bottle of Edelsvicker or the aforementioned bottle of Sancerre in the Loire Valley. But by the same token, I do believe that there are certain building blocks that that wines are on. And while I don't believe, as I said before, in being prescriptive, I do think it's important that people understand core elements and core attributes and what they mean and why they can go in different directions, which is why I say, you know, I'm not going to be prescriptive, but I am going to give you some guidelines on what could possibly be going on. Let you then decide by either experimentation or by choice which one you want to follow. And once again, avoid the either overly prescriptive, you know, you have to do this and I'm going to give you all the science as to why, when there are some very simple things that are, for lack of a better word, science or sensory based. But, you know, taking it to the nth degree, I think, scares more people off. That's why they drink beer or RTDs and not wine, or takes the joy out of it. And wine and food is about to be about, it's supposed to be about joy. You know, it's not supposed to be about thinking if, you know, the molecular, gastronomic, whatever.
Well, good segue, because my next question was leading into that kind of gastronomy, molecular gastronomy movement that we had in the early in the 2000s, and you know, a great Quebecois sommelier, Francois Chartier, you know, came up with this Wolf Taste Buds and Molecules, which kind of took a very hard science look at pairing food and wine. And so do you think this level of depth, I mean, of knowledge is required, or?
You know, it's an interesting thing. I know Chartier well, and actually we just did an event together in New York not that long ago. And I think it's amazingly awesome the way he goes about thinking about things and the molecular composition of flavors, and ergo, you know, things are going to work well together. I worry at times that for your average Joe and Mary Quebec, your average Joe and Mary San Francisco sitting down, that it can be a bit scary for them makes them think a little bit deeper than they want to. However, I know, having tried a lot of the pairings that he's put out there, that they do intrinsically oftentimes work really, really well. Part of that is because of the nature of some of the things he does, which are a little bit more radical, which fall very much in line and in lockstep with deconstructed food, molecular gastronomy, all of those other things. And I do believe in, you know, the concept of flavor layering, if you will, finding aforementioned things. I think that there's a wonderful author out there, food and wine writer, more food writer than wine writer, by the name of Nikki Segnett, who's based in the UK and has a brand new flavor compendium book that's literally just out as we're talking here. And I love the way she approaches putting certain flavors together, not by chemistry, not by the way foods are built, but simply by the way they go together. You know, the way when you go get your hair cut and you're sitting there in the restroom and you're washing and the soap you have has got rosemary and mint in it at the same time, or apricot and coriander, you know, you're like, things you had never thought of putting together, but ooh, that's really good kind of thing. And I like that, although I don't get caught up and obsessed in it. But I do think there's places for all of those things. I think in certain genres of food, particularly things where molecules literally are at play, and the way molecular gastronomy food works, that's probably more critical to it than basic food. But I'll go out here, and at the risk of alienating yourself and everybody out there, I'm a firm believer in basic taste. I believe in sweet. I believe in salty. I believe in sour. I believe in bitter. I believe in texture. I don't necessarily believe in umami. And I know that's a little radical out there. So if you look at umami, you know, your average person, if I say salty, you can say you've had something that's slightly salty or over salty. You and me, I mean, we're professionals. Average person, I get it. I've had food that's too bitter, too salty, too sweet, whatever. But umami literally translates from Japanese as what? The essence of deliciousness, right? And it's sort of this meaty, flavory, MSG kind of thing that's going on there. And at the risk of not being accepting of that, I have never heard too many people go, oh, that's too umami, right? I can create umami. I can give you a really ripe tomato and a red wine and create that for you. Mm. But I think most people don't understand it. And, you know, savory to me is not a flavor. Savory to me is the combination, whether it's in a dish that you've created, a wine that you have made, that the combinations of things enhance a character. Savory is a combo. It's not necessarily a taste, and it's then how you relate to it. So I take exception there. And I know I'm a perhaps a heretic for saying that in certain circles, but I do believe that those basic four things are important and they work in certain combinations. I do believe that texture is important. And I do believe that heat is important, you know, literally actual physical temperature. And then, like I said, Scoville units before, but beyond those things and the way they interact, which I think most people can gravitate towards and understand that, I tend to stay off those higher planes.
Well, and then let's just throw one other curveball at you in that, you know, as our jobs in some ways are often in terms of the customer experience is curating experience. So how does emotion, personnel play into it? So, if, you know, because, you know, we can come in and I think that's our job as Somms is to curate and create the experience that the guest wants to have. So I think of the event as being an emotional experience, and sometimes even the food has an emotional or personality. Does that play into food and wine pairing?
Absolutely. And I would say, and honestly, Mark, 90% of people out there, that's what they remember. And that's what is important to them is the experience itself, who they're dining, who they were dining with, what the occasion was, how much the wine and how much as sommelier or as person, how much we played into that, or how much we also noted that we needed to step back and be around it, be available, but not necessarily be there. And I think that people do that. I mean, I look at my own most powerful wine and food experiences, and a couple of them were, sure, very foodie, winey. I mean, marveling at the food and wine. But oftentimes they were either unexpected, unforced, and just sort of happened. And the people that were behind the curtains at Oz making it happen knew when to step back and just let it rock and roll. Or that it was really more important to me was either a business meeting or B, date night with my wife or whatever it was that was going on, to know that, you know, I should be available for Evan when he wants it, because I know he's going to want to talk about it, but I also know he needs space. So I think those are huge. And I do think that, you know, it's an interesting thing, and it's a fun game I like to play, is when you're stuck at a table, inevitably at some event where you realize in about 5 minutes you have zero in common with the people you're dining with. One of the great things to do is ask people what their most memorable food and wine experiences were, go around the table, and they are so eclectic and so different. And very rarely is it the person sitting around doing a vertical of Lafitte and talking to you about the nuances of this and that together and why the 1847 was like this. And it's more about, you know, I was hitchhiking across Europe with my girlfriend, and we ended up in some funky trattoria outside of Siena drinking a fiasco of God knows what, staring at each other's wine. It was the best thing, food and wine thing
I ever did. And I had the pappardelle with the, you know, the ragu sauce, and it was just the best thing ever, right?
Absolutely.
So rapid fire questions. So when you're at home and you're, are you doing food first or wine first? What dictate?
Ooh, that's a good question. I would say it would be dependent on what I did first. If I have a specific bottle of wine that I pulled out or I have on the table and I really want to do something for that, it will be wine first and I will create something around that. But very often, being a former chef, I will go to the supermarket or the farmer's market. I start at the produce section and work backwards. So I'm looking at what's seasonal, what's going on there, and then I build my meals around that. And then what I will do is actually then pick the wine surrounding it. So I am ambidextrous, bilingual, I go both ways, depending on the mood and the choreography du jour.
Okay. If you could pick any sommelier from anywhere and in the world, any time, to kind of create that you would want when you're having that kind of 7-course, 9-course degustation menu, who is it and why?
Oh, that's a really hard question.
There's yeah, so many good songs. Sorry.
I would actually, and this is sort of going to go kind of counter a little bit of what I said before. I have a good friend in Spain, in Barcelona, by the name of Ferran Centellas, who was the wine director for El Bulli, for Ferran Adria for the longest period of time, who only dealt with eclectic molecular gastronomy food. Let me blow this up your nose while you're eating this and throwing the wine on it. But he's actually not only won an incredibly charming man and very non-intimidating when it comes to that. He knows so much about food and so much about wine across cultures because he's traveled so much and his background is such to do that. And I would feel incredibly comfortable not only having him choreograph the wine selections for me, but choreograph the other beverages for me too, because he's very conversant in spirits and in sakis and ciders and all those other things and works with such a wide range and challenging thing of foods that he's always had to work harder than everybody else.
Interesting, interesting. Okay, so we're going to flip it. So let's say now you're the Somm. Who's the chef you want to work with?
Boy, again, a number of great chefs, but I will tell you a chef, and I don't even know where he is right now, but he always took me aback, was a chef named George Marone. And George got his start. I met him when he was at the fifth floor in San Francisco, which is no longer there. Then he started his own restaurant after that, which went out of business at some time. And then he reappeared at another thing. I worked with Michael Mina for a number of times. He is the only chef I ever know, aside from his just incredible sensitivity of wine and food, along with the late, great Charlie Trotter and my mother, got to throw her in here, is a person who really understood food and really understood wine and the way they work together. And he was so brilliant, but he'd take restaurants, and I think he has more restaurants that he took and moved them up from either not having Michelin stars to having Michelin stars, or not having four-star ratings to five-star ratings or whatever, than any other chef out there. And I get it because he is so brilliant. I mean, he's a chef though, so he's crazy and all that, and yes, that's perhaps why he's had issues.
They usually are. I've had a few pans fly over my head.
Yeah, but he's brilliant, and I would always love to work with him, although it could be challenging.
Okay, toughest ingredient to pair with wine. What don't
ammoniation. Ammoniation. Cheeses. I'm a big fan of cheese, and I'm a particularly big fan of soft rind cheeses and washed rind cheeses. And we all know when they've gone too far and you've got to throw them away, but there's that sweet spot of when they're perfect, the perfect Munster, the perfect A plus, the perfect Pont l'Evêque or Livero. But there's also that point where they get ammoniated, and they start, and that ammoniation is actually part of their charm. That is the single most difficult thing to find wine that is happy with. You have to play, you have to nuke, you have to go with sugars, you have to do, and they don't always work. So I'm fearful of that. I'd rather deal with ferment and anything else. And even artichokes and asparagus and all that is child's play.
To a funky applause, I'm sure would be challenged. So best food and wine pairing of your life. Was there an aha thing?
And maybe, I would say there were a couple of aha meals. Both of them were when I was younger. Both of them were in France. Both of them were at 3-star restaurants. And I'm not saying that to be elitist or whatever, but the brilliance of the two of them. The first one was at Peak in Valence. Years ago, dining with the late, great Gerard Jaboulet, and having never been to a 3-star restaurant before and not understanding what it was all about, having been shown that with the level of even the rusticity of 3-starness that a place like Peak has in Valence, not being in Lyon, not being in Paris, et cetera, was incredible. I was my first company ever meeting a cheese sommelier before, an affineur. I thought that was wild. And then having people that understood that the place there and the food and the wine with so much graciousness and care. I still remember the food. And then the other one was at Les Créères when Gerard Boyer, rest in peace, was still there, and having some food in Champagne. With champagnes that I would have never thought paired together, that he taught me lessons that I thought were brilliant. Anytime I can learn, and again, I'm very curious to that, I think is great. Those were two particular meals that really stuck out.
And don't say any restaurant, but yeah, has it ever been a screw up where you just like, oh, that just didn't make me happy?
Yeah, I've had a couple of honest to God train wrecks from people who were just trying to be shock jocks of the cuisine and kitchen, mm-hmm. and had some of those aforementioned things of, you know, pairing things that just pivotally make no sense, like extremes of acids and things like that, extremes of sugars. Yeah. I mean, can't give you any specific dishes, but I know when I've had,
God. There's been a few psalms that just try to force that rosé champagne with chocolate on you and you go, oh,
you God. Know, and I think they do it in part because they know that's what I do and they want to prove me wrong. And I just walk out of there and I smile and I'm not critical, but I just walk out and they go, what the hell were they thinking?
Okay, so we talked about some other beverages and really wine doesn't have an exclusivity on the table. So no. Other than wine, if you were first other thing other yeah. than wine you would go to.
I'm sort of split between cider I like a lot, different styles, the off dry styles that you find in France, but even the dry funky styles you find in Spain, I like playing with those. I like playing with sake, although I know enough to be dangerous, so I'm actually going to Japan in next month and super excited because I plan to come back with more than being dangerous about recommendations, although nice. I've been generally successful there. I like certain spirits, particularly scotches, I think work well with certain cheeses and first courses and things like that. I'm not a big fan of doing cocktails with food. I know some of my friends and colleagues are. I have yet to find something that I felt was transcending. And then, of course, beer. You know, beers and ales work really, really well, particularly with cheeses, particularly with some genres of spicier foods and things like that. I like to play with some alembics and all that, although they're not my first choice. Only thing I could leave is sours. That's just not me.
You can pass them my way. I'm fine with that. okay, so let's walk through a wine and food pairing. So you have a wine in front of you, and now it's 4 hours later. You're in California.
I brought this. Yeah, and this is a California Pinot Noir. It's from my dear friend Chad Melville, who's down in the Santa Rita Hills in Santa Barbara in the coast. And I'm a firm believer that, you know, when in doubt, Pinot Noir goes with just about anything. It's essentially a red wine in white wine clothing. I mean, there's so many attributes about it being a cooler climate variety that as I go through and I map it, I go through and I look for certain attributes and note them as being more food friendly versus less food friendly. So when I go through a wine, and we'll taste this wine momentarily together, I look for the characteristics in wine, the architecture of the wine. So I am completely agnostic. I don't care what grape something's made from. I don't care if it's red or white, bubbly, whatever. But I look at what is the acid level, what is the sugar level, what is the alcohol level, what is the oak level if oak is involved, and what is the tannin level if tannin is involved. Extremes of those things work well or not so well with food. And if people are curious about that, go buy a copy of Perfect Pairings and read your heart out. You'll learn all about it. So, but when I do enjoy a wine, any sort of wine, I do the same thing that everybody else does. I look at it, I smell it, I taste it, I swallow it, and I measure all of the things and the elements in wine. I pay attention to the aromatics. I pay attention to the visuals, so I want to make sure it's appropriate to what it should be. But then I go one step further. How that's showing well. 2021 estate, Santa Rita Hills. So while I'm paying attention to the overall Pinot Noir varietal character and the cherries and pomegranates and the slightly savory elements that it has coming from down the coast, the almost salinity that the Santa Rita Hills have being the proximity of the ocean and all that, and then the extremely, you know, the more chisel that the wine has being a cool climate variety. But I then measure certain things in my mouth. I measure the acid level, the structural elements. I measure the tannins. I'm measuring the fact that the wine's bone dry. And then I'm measuring the fact that the oak here is clearly oaked, but it's so old or large, it's really adding texture and oxidative elements to it.
So you're just doing a calculation in your own head, okay?
Exactly.
And it's very much on structure, you know?
On structure, yeah. I don't do that. You know, if the flavors layer together and there's, you know, a cherry element to a sauce or a desiccated chutney thing and I can pick up on that there, fine and dandy, but I'm focusing first on the building blocks, the elements of it. And I'm saying to myself that because this wine has an elevated level of acidity, I know it's going to be food friendly because I know it's going to be able to cut through heat. It's going to cut through salt. It's going to cut through richness. It's going to cut through fat. I also know that it's going to cut through a moderate level of heat. I know that it also, if I have an ingredient that's got a certain amount of acidity to it, if I did have, you know, I don't know, some preparation and I threw some kimchi into it at the end and there was a little bit of that pickling or sharpness there, the acid level in this wine could actually handle it. I know that because it's not super oaky, I don't have to worry about the oak dominating the food, no matter how the food is there. I note that because the tannins here are fine, present, but not girding in the way that like a young Nebbiolo would be or a young Cabernet would be, I've got flexibility because the primary thing of how do I counterbalance the tannins isn't a driving thing here. So I could have fish with this. I could have poultry with this. I could have certain shellfish with this. And of course, go in the classic red wine direction there. And then of course, because I don't have any sugar, that's something I need to pay attention to. If I have it with a dish that is slightly sweet, I may want to measure that in my mind because again, I don't like dry wines with super sweet foods. Little sweetness like you might have in a chutney or a salsa, like a fruit salsa or something, one thing, but a sweet sauce, you know, deglazed, something like that.
So you're not going with a heavily reduced sauce here either, right?
Exactly. And you'd over, you know, and again, in the basic thing, this is a subtle wine. I don't want to have a big chunky food with it. And if I had a big chunky food, I wouldn't want to have this wine with it too. So I go through all of these calculations almost automatically. The way at, as an MS is we're taught that you go through methodically pretty quickly. What's it, what the fruit, the earth, the wood, what's going on, inorganic, organic. Yeah, and you memorize that portfolio. I simply add that for sommeliers who care about their food stuff here, that you map the wine on those things. And then you ask yourself, what are on 1 to 10, the acid, the tannin, the oak, the alcohol, and the sugar? And then what do I know about wine and food and how that works backwards? So it becomes pretty easy for me over time. And again, with practice and repetition, I mean, nobody walks out of bed one day and runs a marathon or does a triathlon, but you build over time and you practice, and then you might even have a personal trainer who helps you out to get it there. And you can get it there pretty quickly once you understand the route you need to take.
So let's take the wine and just, okay, so you tell us about it and then you go, let your, I'm drinking kind of a crazy wine today. I'm drinking Aguritico.
So. Ah, Aguritico, lucky you. That's a fun wine.
Very
fun wine.
So really
is
fresh.
Is it Yaya or who's you drinking?
No, it's a small producer called, I think it's, or no, Malmavisia, I think it's called. So
Very cool. So I'm having this Pinot Noir. Right off the bat, as I look at it, you know, the color is perfect. It's a very, you know, it's a light wine. It's not a heavy color. It's translucent. I can read through the papers here that I have in front of me, see through the wine. The color itself is a nice sort of light ruby color with a faded ruby fading to a slightly pink rim, shows appropriateness for being a young Pinot Noir from this part of the world. Most importantly though, on the nose, I always tell people, remember and look for a few things: fruit, earth, wood. Very easy to remember. The fruit here, as I said before, is sort of very much in the tart red vein, which I would expect from part of the world here. So I have raspberry, I have pomegranate, I have maybe on one side a little bit of cranberry, but it's all sort of tart and red and sharp. There's nothing black and there's nothing blue about this wine. It screams red fruit. There are definitely floral elements to the wine. Again, sort of a kind of a light, maybe, I wouldn't call it as deep as lavender, maybe something jasmine-y about it. It's definitely has an earthiness to it, more of an inorganic earth and a saline character to it. I'm not picking up a lot of oak on the wine, so they're my fruit, my earth, my wood. And there's a lot going on. I mean, we're talking about it a lot, so there's some certain complexity here. As I take it into my mouth, I'm going to want to validate and then iterate, so. Right off the bat, everything that I said before is coming through. If anything, there's more of almost an herbalness or greenness to it. I'm picking up almost a, often described of wines of this part of the world, sort of a seaweedish, nori kind of character to it, kelpish or whatever, that saline kind of sea thing coming in. I wouldn't call it sea spray, but because it's a little green. The fruit there is shrill, but beautiful and ripe and red, but but again, at that very austere edge of ripeness. The acid level here is quite bright. I would put it on a medium plus, pushing high. Mm-hmm. The alcohol level, although it says on the label, what does it say on the label here, is 14. I think it's a stretch for 14. I think he's probably printed his label over. It's probably somewhere in the mid 13, high 13. So the alcohol level isn't hard. So the wine itself has aliveness to it. Ergo, I wouldn't want that bigger dish that I talked about earlier with it. The tannins are very fine there. They're not even pulling. They're just barely sensed on the palate. The length is long. It's a really good wine. If anything, it probably needs a couple of years more in the cellar or an hour or two more in the glass for it to sort of unravel. But I would find it to be a great wine at table. As I said before, I think right off the bat, I would probably pick something simpler in preparation. I would pick something that wasn't overly bold in expression, because I think the wine is subtle and I don't want to lose the elegance of the wine. Probably keep things relatively on the simpler side. I wouldn't fight with the wine, like throwing all these herbs and spices against it, because it would be cacophony in your mouth. And I would let it sort of sing and keep it sort of low key. Step back a little bit, let the wine talk.
And because of its subtleness and say, you say the oak that is probably older or a larger, does that influence to how you think about how it should be cooked? Like,
I think at that point, it's almost neutral. I wouldn't say it's almost neutral, but it's closer to an unoaked wine than an oaked wine. I think, as you know, I've always been a firm believer, Mark, that oak is wonderful as long as you don't taste it too much. Mm. And you know, when you're getting there and you're drinking those liquid 2x4s that taste like, you know, Tootsie Rolls and caramel chews and coffee beans and all that stuff, then you do have to think about it strongly in terms of not only perhaps some of the flavor layering that you're doing in your cooking, but the method of cooking itself, because you're going to want to pick up on either certain cooking methods that stress some of those flavors or attributes or characters there. So the cooking method becomes almost more important than the ingredients.
Right.
Or if it's really bold still, maybe your sauce, condiment, or whatever you do on the side might actually be the thread that bridges everything together. On a wine so delicate as this, it's really probably about simplicity of ingredients, simplicity of this, you know, going back to seasonality and, you know, letting both of them sing without one dominating the other.
Perfect. So let's just say if you had something, you know, sometimes for me, it's something, if a dish just popped in your head, what would it be?
I would probably do maybe something like a pan-seared or quickly, lightly roasted quail, something very delicate. Mm. Maybe on that little fire or whatever I was doing, maybe throw some herbs in there to sort of pick up on the herbaceousness of it. I might, for this wine, given the nature of it, serve it with a side of maybe like a little bit of farro, maybe toss some pomegranate seeds into it, time of year that we're at still, to pick up on some of that fruit. And then again, maybe some not super pungent, but lovely wilted greens to go with that, and then leave it alone.
Nice. Okay. Well, thank you, Evan. A great discussion on the role of the sommelier, role as it relates to food and wine pairing, which is, I think, is integral to the customer experience. So just want to take the time. Thank you for spending some time with us. And we look forward to seeing you soon. So hopefully we'll, California, somewhere in the wine world, hopefully we'll get to actually get to meet each other in person someday.
Absolutely. I really look forward to that.
Okay. Thanks.